I have been preaching the gospel that Christ shed his blood to send the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, and that was the purpose of the cross. The first thing people usually want to ask when they hear this is, wasn't the Holy Spirit already in the world? The answer is yes. For you see, the Holy Spirit is the divine presence of God. Men were filled with the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament.
And he hath filled him with the Spirit of God, in wisdom, in understanding, and in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship.
So does knowing this somehow negate my claim that the purpose of the cross was to send the Holy Spirit? I will answer this question with a series of questions for you to ask yourself. Question number one, is it true that Christ died on the cross to bring forgiveness of sins? If you answer yes to this, then I would argue, wasn't forgiveness of sins already in the world?
When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee.
Here was Jesus forgiving a man's sins before he had shed his own blood. Christians offer this as proof that he is God, and even quote the corrupt priests who erroneously exclaimed, Only God can forgive sins, when they heard it. There are three ironies here, then. First is the irony that Christians agree with those who crucified the Lord in that only God can forgive sins. Yet whenever a sinner accepts Christ in their churches, they say to that sinner, Your sins are forgiven. The same exact words Christ uttered, which they say only God can legally utter. Second is the irony that Christians preach Jesus' forgiving sins proves he's God, and then turn right around and preach that God couldn't forgive sins until Christ shed his blood. They have God incarnate forgiving sins before the blood was shed. Third is the grand irony of all. Because the Holy Spirit was in the world before the shed blood of Christ, Christians want to argue that the purpose of the blood cannot be to send the Holy Spirit, even though Christ clearly stated that was the purpose of the cross. While at the same time, they have no problem saying that the purpose of the cross was forgiveness of sins, even though we see God in incarnate state forgiving sins before the blood of the cross. Question number two, do you believe that Christ is the minister of grace in the gospel, and that it was by Christ's blood that grace came? If you answered yes to this, you have the same problem as with forgiveness. For grace was in the world long before the advent of Christ. Even the apostles themselves admit this. Paul, who said that salvation only comes by grace, admits that death only reigned from Adam unto Moses, and then men found grace.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come.
Clearly, if the way Christians tell the gospel were correct, then Paul should have wrote, death reigned from Adam until Christ. Yet he did not, for we know that the Hebrews of old found grace, and they found mercy, and they found forgiveness under the old covenant. Yet another irony, therefore, that Christians argue the purpose of the cross cannot be to send the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit was already in the world, yet have no problem saying that the purpose of the cross was grace unto salvation, even though grace unto salvation was already in the world. If no man is saved by works, and all men must have grace for salvation under the new covenant, then the same must be true of the old covenant. And if any men were saved under the old covenant, it would have to have been by grace, or else Paul was just in error. So grace, mercy, forgiveness, and the Holy Spirit were all in the world prior to the blood of Christ. Yet we preach that the purpose of the cross and the shed blood of Christ was to send all of these things. How can this be? Because the new covenant is the old covenant, only administered in a new and more excellent way and built on better promises.
But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet shew I unto you a more excellent way. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance.
You see, my dear friends, Christians miss the point when they read the writings of Paul, in which he makes clear that no flesh is justified by the law, and that the righteousness does not come by the law, and that there is a new covenant. Christians try to present grace, forgiveness, and mercy as new when they are not. They are, in fact, built right into the old law. It was by grace and mercy and forgiveness that the blood of bulls and goats became an atonement sacrifice for the purging of the flesh of past sins. It was by the Holy Spirit that the priest was cleansed, sanctified, and anointed to carry out these sacrifices. These elements of the gospel in the new covenant are not new. Christians preach Christ's commandments to love thy neighbor as thyself and love God with all your heart, mind, and soul as if they are new commandments, but these two were built right into the law. Christians preach about circumcision of the heart as if it's new and invented by the cross of Christ, when in fact this was built right into God's law as well.
And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live.
The new covenant is the old covenant, administered by a new and better and more excellent way. Even the laws of the old covenant are retained in the new.
For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind, and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people.
Christians erroneously preach that the law has been done away in Christ. This is not what was taught by any of the apostles, including Paul. Christ himself denounced any such thing.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
The Christian message is that Christ fulfilled the law for you so that you don't have to, but that is not what Christ nor the apostles preached. The apostles preached that Christ died so that the law could be fulfilled in us, that by the Holy Spirit we could fulfill the law, and that by walking in the Holy Spirit we would not fulfill the law of the flesh, but rather that we would please God.
There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
The law could not make you righteous, only grace through faith can. This is not something new, but was something that was as true in the old covenant as it is in the new. Yet, if atonement makes you righteous by imputation of righteousness through faith, then guess what? They had atonement under the old law as well. How do Christians not see this? If atonement blood sacrifice makes you perfect and makes you righteous by being counted as righteous through faith, then why would Christ have to die to achieve this? We know that Abraham believed God and it was counted as righteousness, and this happened not only long before the law and even before circumcision, but it happened before Christ shed his blood. The obvious question Christians never ask themselves when preaching their gospel of atoning blood of Christ is, if imputation of righteousness were available to men like Abraham long before the cross of Christ, why then would Christ have to die to bring imputation of righteousness? It was the same imputation of righteousness by faith that was established in the law through animal sacrifices. God promised that he who came to Yom Kippur would be cleansed of sin, and his faith would be imputed to him as righteousness. They had all the elements of salvation that the Christian preaches right there in the Old Covenant. So, just as the Christian asks me, if the Holy Spirit was already here, why would Christ have to die to send the Holy Spirit? The Christian needs to ask himself or herself the same question regarding atonement. If they had cleansing from sin and imputation of righteousness by faith through the atonement under the old law, then why would Christ have to die to bring it? The answer is the same as what I have given for grace, mercy, forgiveness, and the Holy Spirit. These are not new, and they are not what Christ brought to the table with the shedding of his blood, and neither is atonement new. If all Christ died for was atonement so that we could have righteousness imputed to us, he died purely in vain. Why? Because if righteousness is imputed righteousness only, that is the righteousness they had under the old law and under the faith of Abraham. Let that sink in. The only righteousness they had under the law was imputed righteousness, the righteousness that comes by the faith of Abraham. Otherwise, Paul would be in error to say that righteousness doesn't come by the law. If righteousness doesn't come by the law under the new covenant, then it didn't come by the law in the old covenant either. If we have imputation of righteousness through faith under the new, then that is what they had under the old. If that righteousness by proxy, imputation, is the only righteousness that there is to be had, then they had it under the law, which would mean Christ died in vain. Just like grace, mercy, forgiveness in the Holy Spirit, atonement is administered in a new and better way, under the new covenant. The atonement Christ offered as our high priest of better things is an atonement that rescues us from dead works and causes us to serve the living God.
For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God?
The atonement of old under the law could not promise this. It could only purge the flesh of past sins, and it was repeated every year because the following year there were new sins of which to be purged. The atonement Christ the high priest offers is atonement that purges us from dead works. It's much more powerful. For you see, blood of animals, though it could purge the flesh of past sins, according to the author of Hebrews, could not take away the sins. It could not purge us from the sin itself so that our consciences are clear.
For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins.
Christ, our high priest, has made everlasting atonement for us, and this is the kind of atonement for which no further atonement is needed, because once purged of sin, there is nothing for which to atone. Only the sinner needs atonement. The righteous need no atonement. This is all done by the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, which Christ died to send. Is the Holy Spirit new, therefore, provided by the death of Christ? No. The Holy Spirit is God's presence and has existed for all time. Is the Holy Spirit new to men? No. The Spirit has been known to men from the beginning. So why did Christ say another Comforter was coming as a result of his death on the cross and refer to that Comforter as the Spirit of Truth? Because while the Holy Spirit was not new, and holy men of God wrote the Holy Scriptures by this same Spirit, there was another ministration or another way of the Spirit coming, another Comforter. The Spirit isn't another, the Comfort is. Let that sink in. It bears repeating. The Spirit is not another, it is the Comfort or the effect of the Spirit that is another. Christ spoke of several ways we would be comforted after his death, after he went away. The Spirit of Truth is one. And he refers to it as another Comforter, not because it is another spirit, as some erroneously attempt to claim. No, the Spirit is the same Spirit. It is the Comfort that is another, and that is new. It is the role that the Spirit now plays in the life of the believer that is another. For Christ explained that though the Spirit had been dwelling with them, he said, "He shall be in you."
Even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you.
This is what the atonement Christ made does for you. It's the new covenant. I will write my law into their hearts and into their minds. This is the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, who leads and guides into all truth.
And they shall not teach every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, "Know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest."
John wrote of this same anointing in his letters.
"But ye have an unction from the Holy One, and ye know all things. Let that therefore abide in you, which ye have heard from the beginning. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him.
The atonement alone does not bring you this anointing. If it did, the entire world would now have this anointing, for Christ died for the sins of the whole world.
And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe.
The atonement of Christ that he provided by sprinkling his own blood to enter the Holy of Holies and then again on the mercy seat has provided reconciliation of all men unto God. Whereas atonement was only available to the repentant of the houses of Israel under the Old Covenant, now grace through atonement and forgiveness has been achieved by the great high priest for all men, and while they were yet still enemies of God.
For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life.
Notice that the atonement through his blood, the reconciliation, is not unto salvation. It is his life that saves us, not his death alone. He that has the death and the shed blood has the atonement only, the reconciliation, but that is not salvation, as Christians erroneously preach. You must have his life. You must have his resurrection, which comes only by the gift, even the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, who comes to reprove you of your sin, then to lead and guide you into all righteousness. Which is why Paul told the Corinthians, if all they had were the death of Christ, they would still be in their sins.
And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins.
Christ's atonement is just the beginning. It brings unfettered access to the throne of grace, which is where we receive the Helper or the Paraclete.
Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Did they have the Holy Spirit before Christ died on the cross? You bet. And they received the Holy Spirit through forgiveness and through atonement and through washings and rituals. Yet now there is a better way, a more sure way, in which we receive a single atonement offered by our high priest, who is well aware of our temptations and is not untouched and not unsympathetic. The atonement purges us from dead works, and through the Paraclete, Comforter, we serve the living God in newness of spirit through a renewed mind. The atonement of having sins only paid for pales in comparison to this message.